Om Shri Bhyo Namaha. Om Samasta Jana Kalyane Niratam Karunamayam. Namami Chinmayam Devam Sadgurum Brahma Vidvaram. Om Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kamsachanu Ramardhanam. Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagadgurum. Hari. In the first three shlokas, we have seen the introduction to this ninth chapter. Then, next three shlokas dealt with the very theme that Bhagavan mentioned in his very first shloka of jnana vijnana. And that was spoken from the absolute standpoint. Then, shloka number 7, 8 together, which we are discussing, Bhagavan said about this whole creation as we experience it now. And we have seen that this creation is not for the first time, or it is not that creation is there, it goes on and on. But the creation is there, then it goes to the state of being unmanifest. They are called avyakta avastha. Then again it becomes vyakta, manifest. So Bhagavan says, at the end of one cycle of creation, that's called kalpa. And if you see the duration of that kalpa, is many lakhs of years are there, and all that description is there in Bhagavat, Adi Purana and other places. So at the end of one cycle of creation, everything is dissolved. Then again, beginning of new cycle, the whole world is manifested. Thus punaha punaha. So all beings are helplessly then come to manifestation, become unmanifested. But Bhagavan says, I preside over everything and I am the Lord of all that. Prakritim Swam Avashtabhya Visrujami Puna Puna. Now one question. Someone said, this cycle of creation will go on and on and on. And I am helpless, because I am born here. So every time I will be born again and again and again, where is the liberation? Even though in the first loka, you said moksha se, but I don't see any possibility of liberation. Because avyakta to vyakta, then to avyakta, then vyakta, again and again, and avasham, helpless, that born. And if you look at ourselves, we find that we are actually helpless creatures of nature, prakriti. We may think that we are very, very strong, mighty and all that, but even at physical level, at other level, we find we are so much under the control. Try to do one thing. When you feel sleepy and yawning, try to stop that yawning. And when he's sneezing, try to stop his sneezing. Can you? You can't. At emotional level, when some emotion becomes very overpowering and we are so helpless, so we find we are helpless. So where is the liberation then? The cycle of creation will go on and on and on and on. So, the one answer I will tell, Bhagavan has said, and again he will be telling, but have you experienced the giant wheel ride any time? Or have you gone to the Disney World and the roller coaster ride that is there? different rides. Yes. Now, that ride will go on and on and on and on. I go there and I enjoy that. And suppose I say this is enough, one experience is enough for me. Then I go, get out, the ride will go on. This wheel, that giant wheel also go on. Because it is such a wonderful experience, when from the top when you come down, and such sensation in your stomach and all that, and then you feel very nice. So little fear, little scare and that, but you enjoy it also. And some people are there, they go again and again, again and again. They keep watching the same movie 15 times, 20 times. But why do you watch the same movie? One man said, 20 times I watched that movie. Other said, I never got up from there. How come you never got up? He said, I am the operator. The point is, anyway, why you sit there? Because you went there, you liked it. Again, you want to repeat that experience. But when you say enough is enough, and I do not want any more of that, what more? So if your desire is exhausted, then you are out. So this cycle of creation will go on. And as long as our desire remains there to enjoy, we'll remain there. Then one time comes, enough now, I don't want any of this cycle and recycle, and bicycle, and so many kinds of things that I don't want. But I want the Lord who is running the whole show. And when you turn the mind to that Lord, then you are out. So that's called moksha. Okay? Now, another thing, when someone heard this Bhagavan saying, I project this world, then again dissolve it, then again project it, again dissolve it. Someone said, Bhagavan, really I sympathize with you. To run only one family is so difficult. I do little work, you know, it becomes a bondage. And you are running the whole show of not one creation, countless world and all that. You must be tired. You may be exhausted or bored to death. Sometimes that also may happen, you know, saying the, doing the same thing again and again. And you have to deal with such people like us. Then you know, I tell you, must be a terrible job, you know. It must be exhausting, tiring, boring, binding. Sometimes you get tempted looking at your own wonderful creation also. You fall in love with it, isn't it? Somebody paints a picture and he only starts looking at it longer and longer. We start loving our own creation and we fall in love with that. So that also may be happening. Bhagavan, really, your condition is worse than mine. These so many karmas must be binding you or not. Bhagavan said, no. No. Why not? You see the answer now. Sloka number 9. Hey Dhananjaya, Arjuna's name, because he was the conqueror of wealth. Hey Dhananjaya Arjuna, nachamam tani karmani nibadhanti. Tani karmani, these karmas do not bind me. Which karmas, you know? Of the creation, sustenance, dissolution, and presiding over the karmas and karma phalas and all that, you know, leading jivas to their own karma phalagati. these karma do not bind me. Do not bind me, they do not exhaust me, do not tempt me, do not taint me in any way, do not pollute my mind in any way. There is no such thing as nachamam tani karmani nibandhanti dhananjaya. Why? What is the secret that you have got? The secret is udasinavat asinam. Because actually I only sit like udasina. Udasina means, udasina has got many different meanings. One is like a neutral person, indifferent person, disinterested person, or only like a witness. Udasinavat asinam. Asaktam teshu karmasu, unattached to those karmas. The idea here is, udasinavat here, it means I do not entertain any kind of sense of doership. And asaktam, not attached to, that means I am not attached to those karma phalas. If this karma is done, what result will be there and all that, there is no such thing. You know, I had read a very peculiar story, which I want to tell you. Maybe you have also heard or not heard, very strange kind of story. This story was, there was a lion living in a forest. And one day he saw a beautiful girl. Not lioness, human girl. And he fell in love with her. What a frightening thing. And he proposed to her. Now their girl said, how, I can't argue, I can't say no, because you know what will be the consequence. So she said, you know, I always live under the obedience of my father. So you approach him. If he says yes, then I will. So the lion went to her father. Now, do you think the father can say some yes or no? But his father was also clever. He said, you know, I have no objection in giving my daughter to you. But you know, your tusks, your teeth, you know what you call it? Sharp tusks that are there. They tear open it. They will hurt her, you know. So do one thing, remove them. And then if you remove them, then it is fine. And the lion was so infatuated, he went to some dentist and got all his tusks and pulled. And then you can, now you can do it. Now you can. Then father said, sorry, I forgot. One more thing, there is a problem. And what is that? Your sharp claws, they will hurt my delicate daughter. Get them removed. Remove them. I already told you it is a very, very strange kind of story, you know. He went. I don't know where, manicure or barber or somewhere he went, and then he removed all these claws also. Then he came and he said, now you give me. By that time, that man had got, he said, you want to marry my daughter? Oh, weeping. He started weeping that lion. But what happened? Because two most powerful things, they were removed. When the claws are gone, tusks are gone, then he could not do anything. Lion, even though lion. And the man said, you become my vehicle here now. Take me from place to place. Okay, okay. same lion became his servant. You say, what a peculiar story. You know that lion is nothing but karma. And our karmas are capable of swallowing us. We are bound by our own karmas, isn't it? Karmana badhyate jantu. Not by someone else's karma. Our own karmas only. And these karmas have got this power or ability to bind us or torture us only because of two things. One is the sense of doership and the other is called sense of enjoyership. What is called as the attachment, overwhelming attachment to the results of action. When this kartrutva bhava, bhoktrutva bhava that is there, then the karmas become binding. But if you drop that, then what happens? These karmas do not bind, on the other hand, they become vehicle to take you to God also. How beautifully Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi said, Ishwararpitam nechaya kritam chitta shodhakam mukti sadhakam. When the karma, as far as we jivas are concerned, when we do karmas without ego, our Gurudev used to call without ego and egocentric desire. Ego and egocentric desires, they are the two things which bind us. Now ego is surrendered to Bhagavan. No doership and no enjoyership, no attachment to karma phala. Then how can the karmas bind? Now Bhagavan says, Bhagavan's position is of course very different. He says, because I don't have any kind of sense of doership, udasinavat. Udasin, another meaning, ut means above, sitting. If you sit above, see, so the ground is there, which is very, very dirty and support all that. And if you can levitate, little above, 2 inches only, and just can, what will happen? You will be untouched if you are above all that. So above the doership, enjoyership, then the karmas do not bind. Bhagavan says, they don't bind me because this thing I don't have. And Bhagavan Shankaracharya says that anyone who also understands his principle and lives his life, he also will not be bound. That's called Vijnanamda. One is called Jnanam. Bhagavan says, this is the knowledge which I follow. And if we follow that, it will become Vijnan for us. It will become our own experience. At different levels of Jnana Vijnana, you can see. Nachamam tani karmani nivadnanti dhananjaya udasina vadasinam asaktam teshu karmasu. And you can think about it, that whenever you have got this doership, enjoyership, you get into trouble. Now see, look, little children, the karmas do not bind them. You know why? Because they don't have any doership. So the principle must be understood. And a wise man also has no kartrutva bhoktrutva bhav. Therefore, he is also not bound. Now when Bhagavan said this, one more doubt, question. Bhagavan, doubt. There is a question. What is the question? The question is, you are contradicting yourself. At one time, just now you said, Visrujami punah punaha. I project this world, I dissolve it, I project it, I do all karmas. And now you say, I do nothing. Udasina vadasina. So my point is, you do or you don't do. What is the What is your position? Because when we read that shloka, kalpakshaye, kalpado unaha visrujami, so there it is shows that you are doing it again and again. And now you say, no, udasina vadasina, you don't do anything. How is this now? Bhagavan says, I have answered for all your doubts, questions. Only be ready to listen to that and understand. How? Now let us see. This is a very, very beautiful shloka again. Number 10. Arjuna, this contradiction is resolved in this way. The point is like this. Maya adhyakshena. Me as the adhyaksha. Adhyaksha is the one who called president, presides over a meeting. That person, in any committee without president. Is there any committee? Or a government? There has to be some head of that government. So Bhagavan says, under my presidentship, prakruti hi suyate sacharacharam. My prakruti, that is the matter, nature, that only delivers the whole world of things and beings, movable, immovable, everything. It is actually prakruti does everything. I only preside over it. I am only presence. Hetuna anena. By this hetu, by this reason, jagadvi parivartate, the world goes on. So the actual work done is by prakruti. Since the actual work is done by prakruti, I say, I don't do anything. But without me, prakruti doesn't even exist and can't do anything. Therefore, it is said the doership is attributed to me and I did it. Like what? Some example. Any example there? Possible, but now as which comes to my mind. You know, in Agra, we have got Taj Mahal. You know Taj Mahal? Of course you know Taj Mahal. It's very famous from all over the world also people come to see that. Now, who built that Taj Mahal? Generally, what is the answer? That Shah Jahan. Right? Of course, there is a controversy also there. Some people have written that he is not the one who built. But I don't have to go into that controversy because that is not my point of discussion here now. But somebody must have been there. Even if Shah Jahan did not build, some other king also built. But some king also only. Now, so we say Shah Jahan, the emperor Shah Jahan of the Mughal emperor of that time, and he built this Taj Mahal. So we ask, you must be very tired. Because carrying all marbles from place to place and then, you know, with the hammer, chisel and all that, you know, and fixing, putting everything must be very, very exhausting. Did he do that? No. His prakriti. Huh? They were on the cabinet and ministers and they appointed all the architects and then contractors and labor force and all that. So they went on that. We said, this city was founded by such and such person. Vijayanagaram Samrajya. The Hariharan Bukka, they formed and established. Very good. So we say, such and such king founded this city or this building. Or this person they did, But actual work was done by whom? By the force that is there, you know. Labor force there, other force that they keep on doing. And therefore, no exhaustion comes to the king. But without his presence or okay, can anything happen? No. Therefore we say, he built it, he founded it, he did it. Because without his presidentship, nothing happened. Now any meeting also, you know, somebody has to preside who is going to chair the meeting. Even if that particular president is not there, so therefore such and such meeting, first we appoint some person that he will chair or she will chair, somebody has to, then only you can start. Only presence. Once I read a very humorous story, you know, little children were playing, they formed a committee because they observed. So a 12-year-old boy, 10-year, and then what happened? 12-year-old boy was the secretary. 10-year-old boy was the treasurer. And 5-year-old boy was the president. So they asked, what kind of committee? Why that 5-year-old boy only you have made the president? He said, it is like this. A committee cannot be without president. And if you don't take this boy, he will create a problem for us and all that. Because then he will cry and all that, little child, but we have to take him. Now in which way to take him? We can't make him secretary because he doesn't know how to read, write and all that. We can't make him treasurer, he can't count anything and all that. President doesn't have to do anything. He has to only sit there, that's all. The work will be done by him. Maya adhyakshena prakruti suyate sacharacharam. So Bhagavan said, I am only preside, I am only witnessing consciousness. But without that, even the prakruti cannot be enlivened, cannot have any life. So what? Therefore I am there. Therefore the worship is attributed to me that I create the world, sustain it, dissolve it and all that. But really speaking, udasina matasina. But if prakriti goes on doing everything, so therefore I don't get bound by anything. Maya adhyakshena prakriti hi suyate sacharacharam.